Now, what we were talking in terms of the cognitive formation or the cognitive development, okay, now this is what we call as the synaptic pruning. That means it develops. Now, when you see, you can see, you know, the developments that's occurring here. In the newborn, if you see, these are, you know, the small cells, structures which you see here. This is the starting phase. And then you can see how, you know, the growth is happening at 3 months of age. Gradually, when you see, there is an intense or there is a dense formation of these neurons or the nerve cells. Each of these is what we call as the synapses. Right? And these, every synapse or every neuron or every cell that is actually here that you see, it is important for observing certain type of information. So that means you can see how much of, that is why you always see a toddler, that means a 2-year-old child being very active, and you cannot expect the child to sit still even for a minute, okay, other than the time the child is fast asleep. This is because the child is, you know, very curious and the synapses are actually requesting for the thirst of knowledge. So as much as information that we can provide at this period, it sustains the growth of these cell generation. And eventually, let's say if there is not much of actually information or things that is happening, and what sort of information are we actually talking here about? We are talking about information about everything. It includes the 5 senses also. Everything that the child sees, the child touches, the child hears, the child actually says, okay, or the child listens, or the child tastes. All of these are, you know, getting into these synaptic pruning, or, you know, these leads to the synapse formation. And each of these multiplies in abundance as it leads to giving multiple information to the child. Okay, so this is how the child or the children basically they develop in terms of achieving their cognitive milestone or, you know, the information processing. And in terms of, again, the physical abilities, if you see, a newborn will naturally have a lot of reflexes, and these are biological and it is naturally acquired. All right. So these are, again, due to the various physiological development that occurs in the body. And basically, you know, you can see these very noticeably, you can see these, especially, you know, the rooting reflex. When you try to touch the child in the cheek area, the child immediately, you know, tries to turn around to see or, you know, show the face and so on. This is the rooting reflex. The other reflex that gradually develops is the grasp reflex. Okay. So which means this is the rooting reflex, or what you call as the root reflex. Okay, this is the grasp reflex, where the child, as soon as, you know, you try to reach, the child tries to, you know, as soon as you try to point a finger, the child tries to reach out to the finger, or it could be even an object, right? So again, over a period of like 3 months around or so, you can see that the child is trying to startle. That means the child will, you know, try to shake his body or move his body, you know, when the child hears a loud noise or whatever. Gradually, you know, from birth till the age of infancy, the child develops the walking reflex, right? Okay. So these are the various developmental abilities that we can instantly, or what is something what we call as the tangible reflexes. Now, in these occasions, during these reflexes, it is not easy for us to predict whether the child will be able to talk, whether the child would be able to empathize, whether the child would be able to socialize. This is very critical. Why it is critical? Because it is simply not something which we can observe easily. But it doesn't mean that the child is not growing other ways, like socially or emotionally or cognitively. The growth simultaneously occurs along with these physical abilities, right? So, but then these are the root cause. Again, when you say why physical abilities, because it is through the 5 senses. Okay, the child is able to develop otherwise in terms of cognitive, in terms of social, in terms of behavioral and other needs. So understanding the child development is not just only possible in terms of understanding the needs physically, but also to understand how children develop socially, how they, you know, develop emotionally. Like, for example, when if you see a baby, you know, around 4 months or 5 months of age, the child may be bored or the infant may be bored. But how do we know that the child or the infant is bored? The child cannot tell us that, hey, listen, I'm bored, you know, please talk to me. The child is not going to tell you that. So how else would the child be able to express his emotions? Through cry. Okay. So that's why the caregivers, through closely observing the infant, they would be able to understand what each cry refers to. If the child cries at a particular period of time, then the mother or the caregiver knows that, okay, this looks like, you know, hunger cry. Okay. So then, you know, the baby is being fed. And then after that, when the child plays for a while and then the child, you know, again tries to, you know, rub his eyes and tries to cry. Now the caregiver or the mother, whoever the immediate, you know, people, they will try to understand that, okay, the child probably is sleepy now. That's why the child is crying. So similarly, for every development, okay, so let's say you have fed the child has had a good nap, the child had a good sleep, everything seems to be fine, but the child still cries. And the minute you carry the child or the minute you go nearby the child stops crying. So that means there is no discomfort, but the child is bored. The child simply wants attention. So the parent or the mother or the caregiver, you know, tries to initiate a conversation with the child. So talk to the child. So then the child, you know, responds by cooing, by, you know, giving sounds or making the gurgling sounds. So indeed, it looks like a total conversation that is happening between the mother and the child. So this tells us the child has emotions. Okay, the child is emotionally growing as such. And again, when you call the child by the child's name, the child is responding. And when the child sees the caregiver, the mother or the father, the immediate people who the child knows, the child immediately responds with a smile. And the child pays an eye contact. Now, these tells us the child is also socially growing. All right? So with all these factors, we can say that the child's growth is a complex process and it, you know, is something which is very vital for their overall development later on. And there have been many theories which has actually focused. But when you look at these theories, not all theories can focus on all development. That is why you will have plenty of theories in terms of understanding the child's development because of its complexity of the growth and development. There has to be a particular theory which focuses only on studying the language development of the children. There has to be a particular study which focuses only on the intellectual, the cognitive formation of the child. There has to be a particular study which, you know, focuses fundamentally on the social and the behavioral needs of the child. Okay, so this is why it is such a complex area, you know, where one particular theory cannot determine the overall development. So, and remember that, you know, it is always not that the theories that are very important, but the takeaways or the inferences that are drawn from these theories, it helps us to understand the growth that is happening around the child. And so that we are better equipped, okay, in providing whatever the necessary resources or whatever the necessary environment in order to provide the nurturing that leads to the holistic and the optimal development of the children.